ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another edition of Hashtag Comedy TV with me, your host, Mr. Cee. And, you know, it's a program where we take a serious look at the world around us.
Now, special dedication to all dogs of dogs, dedicated to all top dogs, celebrity crew. Man called Tony Kelly, the man called Robert, and while Apache riding show. Curfew! Sometimes some back, some of them are rally back. We are road boy, you tell me no take back, no chat. Sometimes some back, some of them are rally back. But we are road boy, you tell me no take back, no chat. You full of big chat and can't defend that. If a jailhouse you come from, we sending you go back. You full of big chat and can't defend that. If a Bellevue you come from, we sending you go back.
And here we go, here we go. So listen, for the next hour or so, please join alongside me, our regular panel guest, Kane Slim Quincy. How you doing, guys?
We're good, man. We're good.
So listen, Super Saturday this weekend, did you guys manage to go out and get some drinks? Go on, Quince.
I didn't venture out because I knew, being from East London, what it was going to be like. So I shied away and I went to the Tesco, got a nice 4-pack, and Netflix and chilled by myself.
No, what was it like? Didn't go out. Didn't go out at all, man. Stayed in. Go out Super Saturday. Corona is like people forget, you know. They think they're slick. They don't open the gyms. We've got a gym, you just to pay for the membership, and that's it. You ain't spending no money in the gym. They open good up point, places man. You're going to spend money. Yeah, and they're risking point. People's health for it. You understand? So, no, I weren't going out for no Super Saturday coronavirus, not corona drink. You know, go.
Kane, what about yourself, man? Sorry, just can't hear you, Kane. Just check your mic level for me, please, Kane.
Can you hear me now?
Test, one. Yeah. So what about yourself, Kane?
I was in my yard, brother. I was in my yard. Uh-huh. There's no way I was getting... I don't drink anyway. I don't drink. This is me, ginger beer. That's the only beer I'm drinking. That's it.
You sure? Anyway, look, this is a footage which was taken yesterday in Soho. And as we can see, there's not much social distancing going on there, eh? Gee whiz. Absolute madness.
Listen. That is... I don't know why they thought that they'd say to people, we'll open the pubs, go out and have a drink. I mean, if you got a white mate, most people are friendly when they have a drink. But if you got a white mate, believe me, they're the most friendliest, loving people when they've had a drink. If they're friendly with you, that's it. Hugs, kisses, the whole lot. So I don't know how they thought that would work.
There you go. Okay, that was never going to... Listen, you see when white people get drunk, they're grabbing up their friend's body. They go on, grab on, They do all kinds of shit. Pull it down their friend's pants. Go on, have a look at that, you bastard. No. More than coronavirus got spread yesterday. They spread every disease on the planet because they were social distancing.
Yeah. And to make matters worse, to get themselves off of it, right? They're all shouting, it's had a little better. Had a little better. You know what I mean? No, that's not better. Yeah, at the end of the day, for me, right, the worst thing about when you get those kind of individuals under one roof, yeah, they get drunk and they ruin good songs. So, no, I won't be in amongst that crap.
Anyway, here's what's coming up on the rest of today's show.
We kick off today's show with a look at Black Jesus. Is it time to set the record straight with our special guest, Eddie Hypolite? Then we'll be discussing David Starkey and his comments on slavery. And finally, celebrity relationships from Will and Jada's open partnership to Dr. Dre and Nicole Smith's divorce. And we'll hear from our guest, Donna Marie Turner.
Now, I don't know if you've seen or heard about the David Starkey interview, but we'll hear what these damn blacks have to say later on. But listen, this is our platform, Hashtag Comedy TV. It's also your platform. We need you to like, subscribe and share. And please get involved with the comments. We want to hear what your thoughts and views are as well. Right now, let's crack on with today's show. What's been happening in the week? Well, we're talking Black Jesus. Who here grew up with images of white Jesus on the wall in their yard?
Not in my house. Because I don't know about you lot, yeah, but I know Slim had older parents, so I know that you had black Jesus in your house, 100%. Yeah? Mm-hmm. See?
They had white Jesus in their house, man.
My parents are young. I never had no Jesus in my house. It was around my grandparents' house, that was it. So I never had no image of Jesus, no princess die. My parents are like my age. They're like my brethren.
How can you say your parents were like your age, bro?
They're like my brethren.
Yeah, I hear you.
Quincy.
Do you know what? I'm going to be real with you, right? Judging how 2020 is going right now, and people are dropping like flies, this subject matter is very touchy. Because all due respect, I don't want to meet Jesus right now. So I'm going to be very careful what I'm going to say. But when I saw that clip, the image, right, of the black Jesus, I was like, shit, that's me. But I will say, I mean, I don't know what color he is, if he's black or white, but his miracles tends to go more to the black side. You know what I mean? Like he fed 5,000 people with a loaf of bread. Now, we all know here, only black people can stretch food.
It's true. Yeah,
only us can stretch food that far. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. And from the day he was born, he was a threat to the establishment. Now, if that isn't a black man's life, there's no more I can say about that.
Well, listen, this story's been bubbling away for years, and it's most recently come to fore over the last couple of weeks, because St. Alban Cathedral has taken, some would say, some bold steps in replacing the image of Jesus with this. Here, what we've got is a print of by Lorna May Wadsworth. The artist used a Jamaican-born model for the basis of her interpretation of Leonardo da Vinci's 15th century work, which of course, The Last Supper. And she said she wanted to make sure people would question the Western myth that had fair hair, and blue eyes.
You know what? That is a very, very powerful image. You know what I mean? And it's nice that she's shown the pictures of the black Jesus. But the disciples, I mean, in this day and age, if you saw one black guy and 13 white guys, you're going to think, where's his brother coming from? You're going to question this brother. You know, I was never saying, unless the man there bleached, but I think it's a powerful image. There's only one image I had like similar to Kane. When in my mum and dad's house, it was in my uncle's house. And the image that we all know of the blue-eyed blonde hair, that was in my uncle's house. And I remember, like, when I was younger, I used to go there. It was by the stairs. So we had to go up the stairs to go to the toilet or go to the room. They know the eyes used to follow you. Mm-hmm. I was scared of that, and I had to take it down. So that was my...
I don't think that was a picture of Jesus you had on the wall. It was probably a picture of Jimmy Savile. Anyway, listen, Slim, I know you grew up in church, brother. What's your thoughts on this?
Well, black Jesus, well, come on now. The Bible states that he had black skin. Do you know what I mean? So telling the truth, there's nothing wrong with telling the truth. That's how it goes. He would have been of darker skin. He wouldn't have been Caucasian. So offering Caucasian, I think white people know that deep down as well, because they realize exactly where he was born. They know it's nowhere in Europe, so they know he's got to be of some form of colour. Do you know what I mean? The Last Supper picture is wicked, because when you look at it properly, that is a proper black picture. Because a group of white guys gathering like that, there'd have been a lot of drinks involved, that was a food thing. And you know, when we gather, look, that could be like Nando's. Look on the picture. That could be a group of man them in Nando's, looking to run off after eating the chicken. Look at the picture again.
Kane, when you see that image, what goes through your mind, bro?
No, it was wicked, man. It's inspiring. Because like what Quincy, but although what Quincy said was right, that like if you see one black guy with 12 white brethren, you remember Brian from Big Brother? That's what it could be like.
Andy Peters.
Yeah. They should have sprinkled a couple more black people in that picture. But I was happy with it that the black guy was the leader. It's like, you know, like It was, and you look like he cooked as well, because it was seasoning. Mm. Everybody, yeah, hey, what's in that? What's in that, Jay? Wait, what's that? What's in that chicken, Jay? That's lovely, like, it, yeah. So, yeah,
it's so Perry, nice. Perry.
Up, yeah, right. Yeah, well, yeah, a little spice.
Well, listen, right back now, I'd like to welcome our special guest this week. Please, boys, girls, put our hands together for Mr. Eddie Hypolite.
Hey, listen, it's good to be here with you.
How you doing, Ed?
You're killing me here.
Bless up, my brother. Good to see
thanks
you. Welcome to
on.
Our show, Eddie, man.
Oh, man, thanks for having me on. Thanks for having me on.
Pleasure. I just want to say to our guests as well, our viewers, that Eddie, tell them where you are, Eddie, man.
I'm in Australia. It's 10 to 10 Sunday night here in Australia. I'm in New South Wales. I'm in a place called Currumbong. They call it the bong, where we're all getting high on life. You know what I mean?
So, Eddie, I just want to get straight into this, man. Black Jesus, is this a start? Is this the end?
It's a start. I mean, what they really should have done was just be true to history and black out the whole picture. You know what I mean? Right. You don't even need to go to the Bible to know what color Jesus was. Roman historians will tell you that the Hebrews of Jesus's day were dark-skinned with woolly hair. You know what I mean? They were dark-skinned with woolly hair. So it's a start. You know, I mean, what you see with the whole issue of Black Jesus and White Jesus is a reclaiming of our space and our face in the biblical story. Because the biblical story isn't written in Europe. The biblical story eventually ended up in Europe, you know, and then they turned it into the religion of, you know, what went from being the pagan Rome to papal Rome, and then into the, you know, into Europe as Europe just progressed after the fall of the Roman Empire. So Christianity became their religion. But the story of the Bible is written in Africa. It's an African narrative. It's an African narrative with African people, not Middle Eastern people, because, you know, the Middle East, the British invented after the Second World War. So there ain't no Middle Eastern Arab people there either. It's Black African people, you know. Yeah. But as history has kind of shifted, and Europe has taken on the story, you know, they've appropriated it, and they've appropriated it for the I can say everything I want to say here.
No, listen, you know what, pause for that, because I just want to pick up on that, Eddie, because literally the cathedral was saying that, I've got a statement here, they said that we stand with the Black Lives Matter movement to be allies for change, building a strong, just and fair community where the dignity of every human being is honored and celebrated, where Black voices are heard, and where Black lives matter. There we go. So look, does it matter then, really and truly? Michael Jackson sang, it doesn't matter if you're Black or white, but I ask the question, does it matter if Jesus is Black or white? Kane, what's your thoughts?
100% it makes a difference, man. It makes a huge difference. Remember, you know, religion is taught from when you're young. So your mind is a sponge, and your imagery is so important. It's like buying Black children, Black dolls to play with, and having curly hair and Afro hair to play with, just so that they don't feel as if they're less than or remember, you know, Jesus isn't a bad figure. So it's a positive image for the white community, for them to have a white image. Just imagine growing up with a Black Jesus, and you're going to school as a minority and everybody's worshiping a Black Jesus. Do you know how important that is? You walk around, you make people walk around and take off their blazer and put on puddles. Put that down and make me walk on it, because I look like you. But the sense of pride that we would have had. Remember when we grew up, you know, we were a minority. They weren't that. And all the Blacks stayed with each other. We all stuck with each other. Anybody here who went to school, there was Black people in your class or whatever, you stuck with them. And you had white friends as well, but we always stick together. Go on, sorry, brother.
I find it interesting that even the picture here, they've still made Jesus a minority. I'm like, why not even Jesus can win? You know? They might as well have put police in the background. You know what I mean? Because they just made him a minority. And you see, there ain't no point in changing the color of Jesus if you ain't going to tell the truth of the story behind Jesus. That's where you have to start. You have to.
He looks like a waiter at the darts.
I'm serious. I used to play basketball with that guy, man. I went to college in I went to university in Jamaica, and that looked like a brethren I used to play basketball with. Trust me. You know what I mean?
The worst thing. They didn't even give him a shape up or nothing. Like, come on, man.
No. They need to black everybody up so they know that everybody, because if not, it does take away some of the power from the picture.
Now we're at a place now where we want the truth now, okay? We've been quiet for too long. Our grandparents endorsed that foolishness as well with the whole white Jesus in the house and praising him, telling us that Santa's a white man, even though he's made up. It's 007 can't be black, he's made up. It's like everything good is white. So come on, man, it's about time that they give us the full story and tell everybody else the truth. Because it's not us that they need to convince, you know? They have to convince their own people.
Own people.
That's what it is. It's not us, we know already. Their own people.
Yeah.
So Quincy, I know that you had something to say. Sorry about the technical difficulties there, my bro. Go on.
I think the other disciples were trying to mute me.
They were Man City fans.
that picture basically could have been taken of the one black guy that was in TGI's in Essex. Basically, that picture. You know what I'm saying?
You know,
that's
Quince,
Steve. That's Black Steve. That is. That's Black Steve.
You know, Quince, what I wanted to ask you, because obviously where you grew up, Canning Town, you was probably a minority in your school. I'm just thinking, what would Black Jesus have meant to you back then? Growing up in the 70s in racist Canning Town, what would Black Jesus have meant to you back then, bro?
I think that for me, it would have been something which confirmed, which I had from my grandmother, and being from that background, Church of England, Pentecostal kind of background, it would have emphasized my conversations more with some of my white mates growing up. And just let them know, look, you can call me what you want, but at the end of the day, when you die, you're going to see the same Sambo you've been praising.
Eddie, in your teachings...
go on, sorry.
No, I was saying, in your teachings, man, what's your views on this? Give us some wisdom, my bruv, because I know you're an author.
The closest that we got, you know, I grew up in the 70s, and if you're thinking I'm homeless, by the way, I'm just in the middle of moving, in case you think I just come into somebody's house and I'm recording.
I was going to say, Jesus threw water into wine, but he could have turned food into the cupboard.
I was going to start up a GoFundMe page for you, Eddie.
I need it, man. I need it.
Eddie, I honestly thought you was in a safe deposit box and you cleared everything out and you was just about to get away with it.
You already see I'm dressed in black, man. I've got the balaclava just on the floor here, man. You know? I was going to say, the closest that I grew up in the 70s, you know, I'm born 65. So the closest we ever came as black people to ever seeing a black Jesus was through Rastafari, and they call him Jesus Christ. You know what I mean? And so black people left, my faith tradition is Adventist, but I know they left Adventism, they left the Pentecostal church. Black people from the Caribbean, our first generation, they left all Christian faiths and went into something that was historical, that was cultural, that was spiritual, and that was black. Because growing up in England, there was nothing that affirmed our blackness. There was nothing that affirmed our historical place in the world story. There was nothing that confirmed our place in the biblical story. You know, and Rastafari was what was doing it. Now with the passing of time and just so much more information, we understand who we are in this biblical narrative. And so for white Europeans, for the Christian church, especially the white Christian church, who brought us Christianity and they brought us basically theological colonialism. for them now to start reconstructing, deconstructing what they did, and actually teaching the biblical narrative, you're going to have a whole bunch of traumatized white Christians, having to come to terms. Yeah, having to come to terms, not only with
different history,
not only with the way Christianity has been historically taught, but all the other constructs that Christianity partnered with in order to not tell our story as people of African descent. Not just our story in the biblical story, but our story, period, historically. Yeah, our story pre-Christianity, our story pre-slavery, our story, period, you know? And so with this global awakening that you see taking place right now and Black Lives Matters, this is a time when white people have to deconstruct, have to be comfortable with deconstructing their world. Systemic racism, you know, in all of its structures, including the structure that was used by Christianity, is a white problem. And it's a white problem that can only be dealt with by white people.
Yeah,
the good thing about the biblical story, good thing about the biblical story is that, yeah, Jesus was a black man, but he was a black man in an age in which a person's skin color didn't determine who he was, because whiteness is maybe 500-600 years old, you know? So in Jesus's world, Jesus being a black man didn't mean anything. Jesus was just a man. He was a Hebrew, you know what I mean? He was just a Hebrew. And so salvation through the biblical narrative is a world thing. Salvation through Europe is a European thing. You know what I mean? And it's and it's money and it's sold as that. I think what this I think what this awakening is doing is making people understand, no, this story, this biblical story, this Jesus, this whole idea of Black Jesus is bigger than just Jesus being a black man. It's actually about the unmasking of the way the story has been told and telling the story honestly.
Thank you. Thank you for that, Eddie.
Bigger.
Quincy, I know that you had just a quick point, Quincy, just before I move it on.
No, I just concur in what my man was saying. You know what I mean? I think it's a point of white Christians need to convince other white Christians, you know what I mean, of who Jesus was. And when that picture came out, when they're trying to now destruct show a black image of Jesus, I want to see the first sermon. When that white pastor says, my white Christian fellow people, if you believe in the power of prayer now, look at this.
I mean, and you know what? England's already been through it. You've had Cheddar Man, and now you've got Jesus. I mean, like, you're already you're already taking the journey. Just go all the way.
Remember, that image now is from when they created that image until now. That's what everybody's seen. Grandparents, great-grandparents, their children, their cousins. And you think about that, just even psychologically, what that does. Like now, if we can get this imagery changed and make it real to life, you think about the future generations, how they're going to see themselves and how people are going to view us. This is a big move. I know it's baby steps at the moment. I feel like they're trying to pacify us a little bit. At the moment, they're making little gestures. Like you said, with the whole, in the Last Supper, it was just one black face. But you see, if we keep pushing and we can get this done right, this is a historical moment right now that we're in, you know? It's for them to acknowledge it.
And I think don't just think about it for us now. Like you said, Kane, think about it for our children's children.
Yeah.
That's going to be the norm to them. You understand what I'm saying? So for me, that image of that sketch there, you know what I mean? And like I said, our Jesus, as we know as black people, when we are powerful, we rock with a certain boastiness about him. Like it says, Jesus says, the only way to see the Father is through me, innit?
Through a black man. Imagine, you've got to believe in a black man that walked on water before you could go to heaven. You've got to believe
that. Like, scriptures.
Yeah, that's black man. Listen, you're not coming inside here without... No, you're not seeing my dad. Nah, man, wait there. Wait there.
The struggle for Christianity is actually deconstructing the idea, deconstructing the lie that they told. That is Christianity's struggle. And I don't know whether the church is going to be strong or brave enough to do that. But it actually begins in spaces like this. It begins with those of us who teach. It begins with those of us who speak. Every construct begins with an idea. An idea creates a narrative. A narrative creates a teaching, a practice, a policy, an action, an oppression, or redemption. And so I think where we begin is we begin back at the idea. What gave you the idea that not making Jesus black in a story that was black was a good idea? What gave you the idea that actually making Jesus white and then teaching that exceptionalism, that white exceptionalism through that religion to hundreds of millions of people of color, you know what I mean? And therefore denying them their space in that story was a good idea. And I think what we do is we go all the way back to the beginning and we begin to just teach a biblical narrative. We teach a narrative that is honest. Yes. We teach a narrative that is true, you know what I mean? And allow people to see themselves within that narrative, because the narrative is just a human story, you know what I mean? You've got a man who's on a bus, you know what I mean, bragging to his friends, okay? Bragging to his friends. He's a rich man, he's a powerful man. He brags to his friends about how he can abuse women, how he can grab them by their pussies. He can do anything he wants. Mm-hmm. Who is that man?
President of the United States.
It's Donald Trump. All right. So you got another man. Another man. This man is a rich man. He's a powerful man. He has power. He sees a next man's wife. He wants that woman, but she's married to somebody else, but he uses his power to abuse, and he abuses his power, and he rapes that woman. The woman gets pregnant. He tries to cover up the pregnancy by murdering the husband. Who is that man?
That sounds like Zeus.
That's Scagliata.
Listen, you know, in the biblical story, it's King David.
It's David.
King David. Yeah, both men, 4,000 years apart. So the biblical narrative isn't even about how man and man used to be back in the day. The biblical narrative is about how we are, period, and who we are, period. And so if we begin and go all the way back and set people in their right spaces and tell the story honestly, everyone can see it. You know what I mean? Everyone will be able to see it. And so the guy who they got there, who I used to play basketball with at university in Jamaica, you know what I mean? He won't be alone because you'll black out the whole table. You know what I mean? Just black out the whole table and no one will feel away because it's a human story. But if you only make it a white story, if you only make the biblical story about the exceptionalism of one group of people, bringing that exceptionalism to everybody else, then it's going to be nothing but trauma for white people, not for us, because we're already clear.
We know what the story is,
and we know who we are in the story. It's actually for you to understand who you are in the story.
Well listen, we can talk about that.
You're not in the story, but we're good.
Well, listen, Eddie, we could talk about that all day, but I want to move things on and talk about this Dr. Junkra, this so-called historian, this man.
Slavery was not genocide. Otherwise, there wouldn't be so many damn blacks in Africa or in Britain, would there? You know, an awful lot of them survived. And as for the idea, as I said, that slavery is this kind of terrible disease that dare not speak its name, it only dare not speak its name, Darren, because we settled it nearly 200 years ago.
Listen, I can't wait to hear what my conscious brothers have to say about this.
Listen, bro, Flim. Listen. When I watched that clip, I wasn't even upset because I noticed, and I don't say this lightly, he's suffering from mental health, Black people have driven him mad. Run the clip again, and watch this.
Slavery was not genocide. Otherwise, there wouldn't be so many damn blacks in Africa or in Britain, would there?
Now, did you see the rocking backwards and forwards once he said black? Yeah, the last time, listen, when people sometimes lost their mind, they rock a lot. You see it already. You see it out on road. I saw it on EastEnders when Arthur teeth the Christmas Club money to pay for Michelle's wedding. You remember? And they caught him, sent in prison, and he's just rocking. Yeah, that old man has made race actually turn him crazy.
Oh my days, man!
I agree. But you know what's upsetting about it? The man, he teaches as well, and he's got a doctorate. And to think that someone who thinks like that is teaching people, this is crazy to me. This is crazy. It's like if you had a madman, like you said, is teaching people. Now they're listening to him. And remember, you know, he's going to be teaching something that's in on the exams, in the curriculum. And they're answering these questions. And he's saying that genocide didn't happen. What are you talking about? How can it not be genocide? How? Just because there are people left, how is that not genocide? If you target a group of people for their race or religion, and you deliberately try to exterminate that group of people, that is genocide. That is the definition of genocide. Just because there's black people left, then, you mean you weren't successful in your genocide. That's what that was. You weren't that successful, but you tried to kill us. You tried your best. You tried your best. We're very resilient people. And all of us got, how much pity all of us got? They can't get rid of us.
Come on now.
I going through what Slim was saying, you know what I mean, with the whole rocking team, like mental health hashtag is real, because he done a similar thing to Norman Bates in Psycho, where the man was rocking back and forth on the chair. And this makes me laugh. How can you be talking about a subject matter about history and you're the same age of the people in history? Yeah, he needs to chill out. That's all I'm saying.
It's the last of old boys brigade. That's what it is.
Oh, Dad's army. You can do one.
So, you know, Eddie, how important is it to hear people like this be put in their place? How important is it, man?
I think it's absolutely important, because the one thing that is taking place in this time in which we find ourselves is the unmasking of ideas, you know, and systemic racism. Remember, the first lie that white people ever told, or systemic racism ever told, it told to white people first. And it said that by virtue of this, you are greater than this.
Right. Yes.
You know what I mean? Otis Maddins. Otis Madison said that the purpose of racism is to control the behavior of white people. It's to control the behavior of white people, control how they think about these group of people. Because remember, at the bottom of racism, systemic racism, what powers and empowers systemic racism is capitalism and greed. In whichever form, it is the snatching of world resources, world wealth, world bodies, and the amassing and the controlling of all of that. In whichever way you do it, scientifically, educationally, religiously, politically. And so I think it's important that you hear people like this, you know what I mean? For a second, just so that these ideas can be just unmasked, you know, and so that we can have an intellectual conversation about who they are. And then on the other side, just say what we would say as black people anyway, Babylon, and then for Bob, you know, I mean,
talking about Babylon for Bon Quincy, Bon on this before we move on to the next subject.
Just to concur, man, do you know what? This guy has been getting away with this, right, for years. And the reason why he's got away with this narrative, he's never been checked. Now, I don't condone violence, but a certain man, he ain't been punched in his face. A certain man, you know what I'm
saying? Not saying that we're condoling boxing down grumpy old white men. However, if you can't hear, you must feel. But then again, he's not the only one who's an outdated white man. Let's go from one to another. This clip is from the interview with Sky's News ex-police superintendent Kevin Hurley.
The only only way you're going to deal with this is to have a social intervention that gets upstream and helps manage the problems that come from single parenting, particularly amongst young African Caribbean women. And I'm talking about intervening and supporting families when the children are 3 and 4 years of age to prevent them going down this route of rebelliousness and often offending.
So, of course, he was talking about the disturbances in Brixton and Notting Hill and not the ones what led to riot police turning up at Bournemouth Beach. Now, he's saying Black Caribbean and West African mothers are to blame. Slim, do you believe this?
Well, this is not, it's just not one set of people to blame. Mothers should know where their kids are at all times, especially late at night. I do believe it's important that, especially in today's technology age where most kids have a mobile phone, you should be able to know where your kid is at any given time. But also, you've got to blame the government for introducing policies that stopped a lot of discipline and took a lot of power from parents. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? These are the generations now that grew up that you couldn't, I don't want to say you have to hit them or beat them, but you couldn't tell them nothing. You say anything to that kid, you phone social service, pussy, I'll come and get my parents. You understand? You go to prison. That's the truth. And this is what it is now. Now, these generation, because we ain't disciplined them, teachers couldn't discipline them. You understand? They've grown up and they can be volatile and disobedient. Authority means nothing to them. So they're reaping what they sowed. With all them laws they put in and restrict parents, a lot of the youths, then, a lot of the people out of road now and authority are seeing and reaping these little seeds that make us sow.
Okay. Let me say, yeah, I think this problem, it runs so deep because we're seeing the results of something, not from this generation, the last generation, or the generation before. What's happened, they've systemically just deconstructed the Black family completely. So basically, and it starts with economics. So if we haven't got a legacy, we don't have no... How many Black people you know got inheritance? Got lack of their proper inheritance. You understand? Yeah, no. So when we go from there where we're not getting an economic start, how much Black people do you think would be up to no good if they had financial wealth within their community, within their household? They're not, those people that are out on the street, they ain't got money. They're not like, oh yeah, they've got a nice lifestyle. They had the best education. They got good people around them, like-minded people around them. No, they're in the ghetto. They're in the council flats. They're seeing people around them that are like that. It's not just a Black thing. It's an economic thing. And this is the problem that we need to get away from. Him saying about Black women, but it's nothing to do with that. Talk about the economics of it. If they had money and they had education, they wouldn't be doing it. If you go to other parts of England, they do the same thing. And they're white. I'll go up north into those mining areas where the families ain't got no money and because they stopped mining and whatever. It's the same thing that's happening, but they don't report on it. All they want to do is just show this picture of young Black people being disruptive and then coming up with the excuse. Yeah, well, Black women need to fix up. It ain't that. It comes down to money. It comes down to money. And to be fair, sometimes we don't do the right thing ourselves because everybody in here, some inheritance money has been passed down and some family member has teeth it. We've all been there.
Come on now.
I was going to say,
that sounds like a personal thing. Somebody.
Yeah, it was, brother. It was. I'm not going to lie. Right now, I'm supposed to be in the Bahamas somewhere and one of my family members just bought a brand new Range Rover 3 weeks ago.
I was just going to say that judging by the words came out of that DH's mouth, yeah, the first thing he want to do, release that tension, is unbutton that top shirt with his old turtleneck, yeah? And every case which he reviewed, right, which is an arrest of anybody, needs to go back over again. Because if that's his attitude and he was ex-chief of police... Like right. I said, needs to be checked.
It's the policing. It's not only just we're police different. There's different language used with us in the school. A white kid will raise his voice and he's passionate. A Black kid will raise his voice and he's aggressive. You know what I mean? Right. There is overt, there is covert and microaggressions of racism. There is economics. There is a whole bunch of things. Make the ground, make equity. Let there be equity in the way all kids are able to navigate culture, navigate society, navigate opportunities, you know what I mean? So that people ain't pushed into one set, one buttonhole of outcomes in terms of work or outcomes in terms of education, coming out of school, coming out of college, et cetera. And then maybe you can start talking about those things. Maybe then you can start talking about families, because everything is equitable. Everything is not only just, there's not just equality, there's fairness right across the board, you know? And I'm not saying that we don't have a certain level of responsibility. I feel like my generation at 55, you know, I'm the father to children now. My daughter is 16, but my generation, we're the parents, the 30, 35-year-olds, 36-year-olds. We were so busy burning down the country in the 1980s and rioting through Brixton and then rioting through 76 and through 81 and 82 and all the rest of it that we didn't even have the chance to tell the story of our parents coming to the country. So when I would do something like Coming Black Around, I do a workshop called Coming Black Around every November. When I tell African Caribbean children that when our parents first came from the Caribbean and from Africa in the 60s, that we live like refugees, five families, one house. They're like, nah, you're lying, man. Nah. We never live like that. And then I'll say, go home and ask your parents. The house that you were born in, did your parents move from the Caribbean into that house? No, they bought that house eventually. So they don't even know our story. And I don't think we took the time to tell our story because we were just struggling to make our way through England. We were literally struggling through the 80s to make our way through England. And when we started becoming parents in the 80s and the 90s, you know what I mean? Up until we find ourselves. So let these people deal with all these social conditions that create those spaces, and then maybe we can have that conversation. But until then, like Quincy says, man, undo your top button because you're choking, you know.
Absolutely. Well put. Well, look, let's have a look at this short clip for an alternative view on Great Britain's glorious past.
The Aborigines were deemed to be subhuman, little more than animals, which was to justify not only the theft of their land, but their extermination. An edition of the Encyclopedia Britannica, still in circulation when I was at school, described them as only an animal of prey, more ferocious than the leopard or the hyena. He devours his own species. So they were hunted and raped and massacred. And few doubted at the time that genocide was official policy. A government report in the 1850s spoke of the success of poisoning Aborigines, 100 of them laid out at a time.
Wow, look at that, man. And they want black people to be the first test for coronavirus. Look, this is that was a treatment of the original people of Australia. Absolutely shocking, horrific. Eddie, you live in Australia. What's your views, man?
Well, you know, we had the Black Lives Matters march here. And the Black Lives Matters march here was for police killings of Aboriginal people from the 70s up until actually last year. 400 Aboriginals have died in police custody. And not one police officer has ever been charged, let alone arrested, let alone gone to court. So it's the same. Aboriginal people, they had their apology, but Aboriginal people still don't have self-determination in this country. They're not even written into the constitution that guarantees them their own self-determination. So, you know, the struggle for them still continues. The struggle for them has never stopped. It's never stopped. They're a proud people. They're actually a beautiful people. And they are a people that, there's a deep thing that with Aboriginal people, they don't tell the story of who they are, of country, of history to a young person until the young person comes and asks them. Because they say it's not until somebody asks that they're willing to learn and willing to listen. And I've always found that beautiful about them. Like, when you come and ask, I will tell you the story. And so just like African, just like Black people within our tradition, everything's held within the oral tradition and they pass down the oral tradition. And yeah, so the struggle still continues for them. But you know, Black people, you can't kill us. We don't die, we multiply. You know what I mean? We multiply. You know,
we don't get vexed. We get blacker and beautiful, man. Yeah, Slim, have you got any thoughts on what we just saw as regards to the genocide there of the Aborigines?
Eddie, really, I don't want him to go without asking. I mean, how long have you been in Australia?
I've been there 7 years now, you know, Slim. I came out here to work. I came out here to pastor. And I pastored at the university, Avondale University. I pastored at the university church. I was the first Black pastor at that church in its 150 years. You know,
wow.
Man.
How do you find it? Well done.
Black London for them.
I like that. Yeah. So church, the church had to change the timing on the church board then.
Hey, no, man, I kept it tight. You know what I mean?
We keep it tight, wicked. How do you find it being a Black man now living in Australia compared to maybe how the Aborigines back in the day was?
You know, funny enough, I said it to somebody the other day. As a Black person, I know that my Blackness is dealt different from an Aboriginal's Blackness.
Right.
When an Australian sees an Aboriginal, they deal with their Blackness different than they deal with my Blackness. Because when they see the Aboriginal, they see their guilt. When they see an Aboriginal Black person, they see their trauma inflicted on that person. When they see me, you know, they'd see, you know, Idris Elba.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, that's right.
When they see me, they see a whole other experience. So I navigate the country differently. I say to my daughter all the time, listen, in this country here, as in the world, you do not navigate this country like your color is, like your Blackness is a problem. When somebody has a problem with it, you will address their problem with your Blackness, not your problem with your Blackness. That's you know, and then if that can't be resolved, then, you know, mug them off and let them keep walking. Tell them a job.
Thank you so much.
That's how we navigate it here. You know, I'm from London, so when I walk in a place, I'm supposed to be in a place. And sometimes people will look at me like, are you supposed to be here? And I look at them like, money is your money.
Come on now.
You walk your head high.
I'm supposed like to be. Lion. I be. Yeah.
Well, listen, Eddie, we've got to love you and leave you, my brother.
No, man.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Respect, Eddie.
Listen, you know, you've been a great guest. Definitely want to get you back on the show. I know you've got a book. Please tell us quickly the title of the book and where we can get it.
My book is called Living From Here. If you go to my Instagram. And just go down in my bio, you can get it. Or you can go to my website, which is eyrltd.com, and you can get a copy of my book there. It's a book that I wrote on resilience, and it's about how we live from the here that we find ourselves in. So thanks for having me, guys.
Definitely, man. Listen, Eddie, take care. God bless, man. We'll catch you again soon on the show, man. Give him a round of applause, guys, man. Big up, man.
Listen,
we've got to move on. I'm now looking forward to this part. But first of all, for the next part, now, first of all, have a look at this.
I actually sat down with Will and had a conversation due to the transformation from their marriage to life partnership that they've spoken on several times, and it, you know, not involving romanticism.
Mm-hmm.
He gave me his blessing, and I totally gave myself to that relationship for years of my life, you know? And I truly and really, really deeply loved and have a ton of love for her.
Of course, that was August Alincina. At this point, I'd like to bring another voice to the conversation. Please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome Donna Marie Turner.
Donna!
Donna!
Big up yourself. Look, I pull out my ear thing. You get me excited. I pull out my ear.
Welcome to the show, Donna. You're looking absolutely gorgeous, man. Those earrings. Wakanda,
thank
sister.
You. Thank, just for you lot, man. Just for you lot.
Respect.
So Donna, look, that clip.
Yeah.
The man's confessing his love.
It's the first time I've ever heard Joe Grind talk out the things, you know, like that.
Like, Joe Grind.
It's just like people been taking side piece for the longest. This is not new, you know?
Yeah.
But sightings are now talking. Like,
yeah.
It's mad. I just, what did they think was going to happen? Like, you don't give away.
Donna, did you think he was right to talk or not?
Boy, for me, he's a younger man, so I don't know what you thought was going to happen. Like, he's going to talk the things.
Yeah. He's going to use the situation to his advantage.
Listen, Jada Pinkett has to be easily one of the most desirable black women on the planet, yeah? She's a good looker. He got the pums. Yeah. You feel say he's not going to talk it? Young man like that, that's barbershop material for decades. Hello.
Yeah.
No, man. You see, that's nowadays use. You understand? Because they got examples like 6ix9ine. You see what I mean? Right. Snitch is the nowadays thing. Back in the day, look, I've dealt with an older woman when I was younger. And the first thing I knew, shut my mouth. Because if you shut your mouth and hold your corner, you get more of the problem.
You get more.
You understand? Yeah. You don't walk and chat and talk and it get round to her. She just lock off supply. Nah, man, you learn to hold your corners. Shut your mouth.
You know what, though, Slim? You're right. You know that August was, he was 22 when they first started. 22. Wow. He's going to chat.
Yeah.
He's going to chat.
He's going to chat.
One at a time. One at a time.
Now, let me tell you, Slim.
Slim.
Go on.
Slim, go on.
No. Listen, I'm telling you now, when I had my big team, I was like 20. And at the time, she was 33. Right. I didn't walk around, boast, chat, nothing. She looked young for her age. She didn't look 33. She looked in her 20s.
Your dates right here.
No, I know. I got my dates right. I know this is what everybody knows, yeah? When I say everybody, my family,
yeah? This conversation.
Right. No, I'm telling you, I'm not you. All right, Samson? You're the one giving it around with your old locks, Samson locks, Looking for it to get cut off, I'm not like that. My dates are right, But I learned to, you keep your mouth shut. I was always like that. You keep your mouth shut, man. Women don't like you chitty-chatty like that, chatty-patty. What the rats? You lot are chatty-patties. That's what it is. You lot say you lot are chatty patties. If you lot would have talk, you lot are chatty patties.
I've got a question for you lot. I've got a question for you four, as I've got you all in one space, right? Wow, in this whole story, for me, having a side man or woman or having an extramarital relationship, people give a lot of this to it, but we all know it goes on said way, yeah? What do you lot think as men, right, about Will Smith? The fact that he gave that the rubber blue stamp. How do you look? I'm interested to hear. All right. Because I know all of you differently. Let's just be, I know you guys. Yeah. I'm interested to get feedback from the generals them. How you feel about a man like Will who said, go through and do your thing, my boy, Spud?
Let me tell you, you see me in a relationship, I'm petty, innit? I'm petty. Brother, if I found out, this is what about me giving a blessing. If I found out that you was with this brother, let me tell you something. The way how I'm petty, you can't celebrate nothing in August. Summer's over for you. Don't mention Leo. Don't mention nothing connected with August. Nothing. I bring it up every time. I have to go and find 3 bitches, April, May, and June. Just to fucking... Just to try and get back at her. You think...
Look, he gave her permission. He gave her permission. And look, in America, is a different thing. Let me tell you, when you're in Hollywood too long, Hollywood's not a real place, It's like Disney World. You can't take it Like, it's there, but don't get, and I think they hooked up too much in a lot of freaky deaky shit.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's why it is. In America, it's freaky deaky. That's why they say they're life partners. So don't think that Will ain't going out and stretching somebody. Will's getting his piece somewhere. It's like an open relationship, but they're not never gonna leave. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? He knew the boy was coming round his house. He knew the boy was coming round his house.
Let's have a look at what Will's got to say about this.
We refer to ourselves as life partners, right? Where you get into that space when you realize you are literally with somebody for the rest of your life. There's no deal breakers. There's nothing she could do, ever. Nothing that would break our relationship. She has my support till death.
Donna, have you heard your man declare that about his love for you, that there's nothing you could do ever, lifelong, forever? How would that make you feel as a woman to know that your man gave you a free pass?
Jesus. No, I do. That's like, I don't know, but I was listening on your show earlier on and I understand the need to deconstruct Christianity, yeah? But one of the tenets of Christianity is what we currently understand as marriage. So really, although we might be like rarest way out there, but aren't they like the forerunners in kind of modern current context of actually deconstructing what we consider to be the rights and context around marriage? Yeah. And before they picked us up in Africa, what did we practice? Weren't we life partners? Like, you know, it wasn't uncommon for a man to have several life partners in his compound with his combined children, whatever. So are we, I'm just saying, like, are we not actually buying into the same thing that we spent the first half of the show saying, that's got to go, it's antiquated, it's outdated, and da-da-da-da-da. But yet we're criticising to say, actually, Jada and Will are breaking the parameters of their... I'm not saying we are, I'm saying, like, some people have commented... But really, what is marriage? If we're going to bring down Christianity, and Christianity is the basis of economics, marriage, and all of that kind of stuff, then don't we have to also bring down what the thought process is around marriage and contracts and life partners?
Agreed, agreed. I tell you what the problem is for me, though, Donna, yeah? It's not even that they're doing it. It's fine, yeah? But when you hear... Even you could dream that your girl sleep with a man and wake up Bex. The dream or have vision to be sitting down in front of the guy and say, yeah, man, it's all right. And he's younger than you as well. And you know that this brother was freaky as well. You saw his hair. He looked like a character from Batman or something. Yeah, you understand? The man had some messed up suit, two half suit on. You know he's role playing with Jada.
Yeah.
And they're doing all kind of mess in the bedroom. I couldn't allow that, brother. I'm sorry. My own pride. And I'm not knocking Will because that's his thing. Obviously, he's tearing that other crutch. But if a younger, good-looking guy is tearing that, my girl, brother, me, Nasa, no, brother, I'm sorry. Somebody's getting poisoned in the house. Someone's getting poisoned.
Quincy, what's your thoughts on open relationships?
Next question.
No, come on, bro, man. Dig deep, man. What's your thoughts on open relationships, man? Come on. We're here for an honest debate.
No, open relationships, you have to be so brutally honest with each other. I'm a believer in marriage. And the life partnership, that's Will's way of saying, I can't do nothing for this woman no more, intimately. So she's up for game, as in open relationships, as long as that you are open and honest. But what happens, and this is what this young man, August, has done, he's basically, it actually made me desire Jada even more. That when a woman makes a man chat, you know how good the underneath is. That's when... You know, she's so good, yeah. She was so good. He chat the things And Jada's nice. Jada's so nice, I'll probably smash her mum as well.
That's spite. Watch me. Watch me. That is spite. Yeah, because if you check it, he's talking now. Mm. He was collecting the pom-pom long time. So how come it's only now he's chatting about it?
He's got an album coming out.
He's got albums. Is that what it is? Well, he's chatting for a reason. But I know he ain't getting no more of her. It must be over for him to say, all right, it done. Me, I got chat. That's what it is. Yeah. It's sour. Sour grapes.
I've got another question for you, love. I've got another question, yeah?
Go on.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right, on a slightly deeper level, same situation. What do you think about, like, Jada in terms of him coming to their household in the first place through his friendship with their son, yes? He came, he was an addict to Percocets, he'd had some loss of life within his own personal, like, family and that. So he came as a vulnerable, not adolescent, but younger man. Yeah. Do you think it? Because if I'm saying, well, when the story busts, you know, I'm saying, right, if it was the other way around and he was a young, if it was a young woman and it was Will, people would have gone mad about how he took advice, rare, and all the rest of it, and he's a pedo and da 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 da. Well, not pedo, because obviously August.
Yeah, but
is
they would have said that.
But the context would have been around
grooming.
That.
Grooming is probably the term that would have
been.
Notice, it's a vulnerable male, that has been preyed on or whatever, do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. By an older female in her own home. So within a safe context, somewhere he feels safe, where he feels this is a safe space, he can talk, he can be relaxed. But I saw those pictures. You know, body language speaks. That wasn't no mother and son red carpet hugging up. You know that weirdo?
Yeah.
But it wasn't going to be like that.
Slim, my point is, do you see how society, when it's a younger woman, we come out and... But when it's a man, how often do you hear us talk about male vulnerability and fragility, right, when people take advantage of people because of their emotions? And I think for me, as a next big woman looking at Jade, I'm like, no, you're wrong. You're wrong for that. Yeah. You're wrong. Because you took advantage.
There's things you got to put it in context. Like, you know, if it's one of your mum's friends from church, you know, like Sister Augustus, and she said, welcome, you want some more dumpling, and you're looking nice, you know, Miss Sassy. But if it's Jada Pinkett,
I don't see no problem. I'm gonna be honest with this. I agree with Donna. The narrative would be completely different if it was the other way around. If it was Will, with a 22-year-old woman, they would be slaying Will now. They wouldn't be people backing him. It's like how Jada's getting, Juan, Jada, get your thing. People wouldn't be saying that about Will. Are you mad? Brother, what world do you live in?
No, bro, you missed the point what I'm saying. The point I'm saying is, it's not about the fact that he was... For men, it deals on how Chris the girl is. If she looked like, say, Susan Boyle, everybody would have been outraged. But because it's Jada Smith, if that was your son at 21 and Jada was mashing out your son, Kane, would you be happy or sad?
But listen to this, though. Listen to what you just said. What you just said answered Donna's question. You just said, if Jada was mashing out my son, so that makes you know that she's got control. She's mashing out the man. That lets you know. So he's gone there vulnerable. He's vulnerable. This guy's had death in his family. He's addicted to drugs. And the next thing now is in relationship with her. Bro, they've taken advantage to some degree. She's meant to draw the line and say, I never knew about that until Donna just said that, you know? I never knew that until Donna just said that. She's supposed to be responsible. If Chris come into my yard and my girl said, you know what? You can do what you want, but this girl's 22. And I wouldn't feel comfortable with me starting up a relationship with this girl knowing 100%. She looked at me like a father figure. I wouldn't feel comfortable. I'm not going to lie. I might take a little side piece. I might, but I'm not coming,
On a real, going back to what Donna was saying, if you check the interview, he didn't look well. He looked vulnerable. He did look vulnerable. He looked that he was at a place where I think he truly thought that he was in love with this woman. And I think Jada
did take advantage of the young thing. And but from how society views it, it's going to look upon, it's easy for us to turn around and say, yeah, man, mate, shut your mouth. But on a bigger level, you know what I mean? On a bigger level, it is a situation, being the people they are, seeing this vulnerable individual, and like, and look, I've seen that guy from, he was young, he's lost a lot of weight. Yeah, and he, and you don't go on an interview looking like the Joker and having a what colour hat he had on the back of his head. But he looked sick and he didn't look well. So I would say, with the Jada thing, me personally, she took advantage. She took advantage. Both of them did, her and Will.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well. Yes. Will enabled it. Will facilitated that and enabled you. You know, go jail for enabling.
You know why? Possibly. I think as well, he set up, if he did have something to do with giving permission for all that, do you have to remember this boy can't compete with him as a man financially and most probably emotionally? So most probably that's why, you're right though, what you say, but that's why most probably why she went young. Do you know what I mean?
I don't think that Will, personally, I don't think that Will has been as emotionally or intellectually mature. Like, from I saw him say at the beginning of his own relationship with Jada that he couldn't compete with Shaq. Like, he didn't feel that he was man enough to
Tupac.
I'm like, well, I don't know. Isn't that at the beginning? And that was at the beginning, the outset of their relationship. Isn't that the time when you kind of set out your boundaries within a new relationship? So that would have been the time to say, I don't mind it's your brethren, but, you know, we've got lines here. And the fact that you can, all right, there's one group might say, well, at least he shared his male vulnerability, but I'm used to a man being a man. So for me, I'm like, brother, like, you just want to head, knock him upside his head, like, well, go on for you, Will. You're just always on some back foot business and this woman runs the thing. I'm all for, like, women empowerment, but for the love of God, take control over your yard. Your son's in a skirt. Like, what? I don't understand. What's going on?
Yeah, they're a freaky family, man. You know they're freaky. Yeah.
Hollywood's got to them.
But what it is, because they're such a prominent black family, that's why we take so much notice of them. And they're very vocal in certain things. But I don't understand why they're denying it, because everybody knows it's true. They're denying it. Jada come out and said it's not true. Yeah, they're denying it. But we know it's true. We know it's true, but they're better off just coming out and saying, you know what, this is how we live our life. Yeah? Don't judge us. This is our life. Right. But they're denying, making this guy look like he's a liar now. And it's wrong. It's wrong. You took advantage of the guy. You basically mandatory raped the man. And then now you're saying he's lying.
And affects
it. Don't help with a presidential election, innit? They said that Will Smith wants to be president one day. That won't help with the election. That's never going to happen. Yes. Never say never, you know. Ronald Reagan never got in never. There and he was in Cowboy. Look at Trump.
He was an actor.
Listen, come right on now.
Never
right
say
now,
never.
Yeah, but right now, Kanye West is trying to go for presidency, yeah?
That's never going to happen.
I don't care how much Yeezy sells. He ain't never getting in.
Kanye West he's going to be what? Did you say Kane?
He's running for presidency against Donald Trump.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. And he's got the backing of Elon Musk's money. It's no joke, brother. You're gonna never say never, bro. I've got four pair of Yeezys right now, so I might even vote for him. Yeah, man, bad words.
Well, listen, guys, that's all we've got time for this week. I want to say a big thank you to you, Donna. Oh, my gosh, what a guest you was, man. And the questions you had for us, thank you so much. Yeah. Absolute pleasure having you. Wish you all the best. Have you got anything coming up soon, Donna? Anything coming up soon?
A couple of conversations about race I'll be convening, but I'll be doing that live on my social media, so... Yeah, on IG, it's Biggest Food. That's you can follow me on that.
Definitely. Well, we'll look forward to seeing much more from you. So listen, it's time for me to bid the gents goodbye. But before I do, Slim, have you got anything coming up this week?
Bro, I'm just, it's home economics and improvements in the place, man. I have to cook for myself and I'm doing up the place slowly as well. So that's what I'm doing all week, yeah? Baking and nailing, that's it.
Baking and making, big up yourself. Kane, I know you've got your dating show. What's the dilemma for this week?
All right, listen, this week I don't know what the dilemmas are, but I want the viewers of this show to send me, all right, any dilemmas that you might have that you want me to discuss. To be honest, I'm actually speaking to Donna now. I'd like Donna to jump on my live. It's on Wednesday, Don, at 10 p.m. All right, so jump on my Instagram live, Kane Brown Comedy, and yeah, jump on and we talk the thing. We just do the truth on my show.
Mm-mm. A lot of people relationship I got broke up this week, boy. Yes, last but no means least, Quincy, what have you got? What's happening with your radio show this week, sir?
This week, Supreme 10 to 1. I'm in conversation with two great pioneers, Trevor Sachs from Saxon Studio and boxing trainer and promoter, manager, Tunde Adejaye, Anthony Yard's manager. I'll be speaking to him in conversation this week on Supreme Mondays, Wednesdays and Fridays.
Wonderful, wonderful, man. Well, listen, that concludes another week of Hashtag Comedy TV with us, guys. Please, please, please remember to like, subscribe and share. But most importantly, send us your comments and your views. You know, one of the things that we like to do is always highlight the good things in our community. So this Tuesday, remember, it's our penny power. But most importantly, as a kind gesture, think about those who make kind gestures. And think about people like our Prime Minister, who likes to make his own kind of political gestures.
Would you take the knee, Prime Minister?
What I want to do is substantial... well, let me give you my answer. I don't believe in gestures, I believe in substance. I don't believe in gestures, gestures, in gestures.
Can you get me a rope?
I want you to consider this. Kipper, Kipper, Kip, Kip, Kipper.
I don't believe in gestures.
Good afternoon, everybody. Hello, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for coming.